Nothing in Magic the Gathering is funnier than the players themselves being upset, angry, frustrated, or even surprised at the idea of variance affecting their game. Perhaps it comes from this idea built up over time that Magic is the greatest cerebral sport known to man. It's chess, but with tens of thousands of pieces and creative control and room for true innovation. The idea that one single top deck, a rigged shuffler, or dare I say a dice roll could snap your well-deserved win away from you tilts out a nerd more than anything else in the game. They've worked hard for that win. Why should variance take it away from them? Weirdly, there's also a flip side to this, the exact opposite of this intellectual grandstanding or pedestal we put up our performance in the game upon, which is where, instead of being self-reflective or analyzing our mistakes, the decisions that led us to this moment of failure or defeat, like for example, how we built our deck, metagame choices, mulligan decisions, and all the other plethora of decisions that got us to this point. Instead, people often just blame variance as opposed to looking to figure out how they could be better in the future. The top deck, the opponent's luck, the mana flood, the mana screw, and all that crap. And of course, we're seeing that a bit more now with the new Adventures in the Forgotten Realms, the Dungeons & Dragons set from Magic that should have been out for about a week in paper, maybe 2 weeks in Arena by the time this video comes out. Adventures in the Forgotten Realms brought with it a dice rolling mechanic used to evoke the mechanical actions associated with a game of Dungeons & Dragons. I spoke last week in this very video series about its approach towards ludic elements of other intellectual properties being engaged with. You should probably go watch that video as well. But for those of you who don't know, the base roll that you see to see if you achieve an action in Dungeons & Dragons is rolling a 20-sided dice. You add or subtract modifiers to it, and then the Dungeon Master tells you if you succeed, with rare cases where higher rolls might succeed by a larger margin. And across the land, from Twitter to Reddit, in YouTube comment sections like the one for this video, people are complaining about losing games of Magic to a D20, whether they didn't roll what they needed or their opponent rolled what they needed. They're complaining about this added layer of variance to a game which weirdly already has a ton of variance. I mean, how is it any different for your opponent to roll the D20 on their treasure chest than for you to top deck the card you need, or for your opponent to top deck the card they need in the exact circumstance that they need it? Magic is a game based hugely on the idea that variance will factor into the game and make it a better game. The resource system itself of Magic the Gathering, for better or for worse, ingrains variance into the very heart of what we do when we play a game of Magic. But beyond lands and flood and screw, variance is a large part of what makes Magic the Gathering Magic the Gathering. In fact, listen to a lot of other games in the same way. Like matchups. Like, I play D&T and Legacy, and I would like to dodge elves at every given opportunity because the matchup is bad for us. Like I said before, it can be top decks. It can be your opponent drawing that fourth copy of a card you didn't want to see. When they've drawn four copies of Path to Exile, it can be quite tilting. And of course, I don't think Magic is a complete game based upon luck. I think skill factors into the game heavily. I think skill helps to offset that variance massively too. Magic is a game of skill. But to pretend that Magic isn't a game in which variance is important or a key part of what makes Magic Magic, well, that's a porky pie, which is Cockney rhyming slang for a lie. So let's just take my point that variance is part of Magic as a given and talk about the idea of adding more variance to the game. What about the fact that we're adding more cards that had random outcomes to the game of Magic? This is potentially a problem for sure, but cards leaning into variant gameplay isn't all that unusual or new to Magic. Adventures itself has 21 cards in it that involve rolling d20 to resolve a trigger, which is certainly above the rate of RNG cards that normally show up in sets. So I'm going to say we can't ignore that. We can't ignore that they're adding more to the set than usual. But that said, although there's a mechanic that has variants in it, cards with variants on them exist in Magic the Gathering, always have, and always will. Mirror March is a recent coin flip card that saw plenty of Twitch clips featured on Channel 5's very own Top 5 Plays videos. Meanwhile, Collected Company and Aetherworks Marvel both had very low floors in terms of what they could do because there was an element of randomized card selection to them. There's a chance you hit nothing, there's a chance to whiff. There was a failed state. But again, you could be adjusting this and teching into it to make it less likely to fail in deck construction. There are a ton of cards that see a lot of Commander and Constructed competitive play that have variants built into them. From your Chaos Warps to your Urza's and Mind's Desires to your Delver of Secrets to a lesser extent, whilst you can affect it with deck construction and cantrips, sometimes you aren't just raw dog flipping cards off the top hoping for it to be a Delver. Hell, Miracle was a mechanic with Terminus and such where people said it did add more variants to the game because you are just looking to flip a Wrath off the top of your deck. You're praying that's the next card. You're praying for a Miracle. That said, there are actually only 256 cards in all of Magic that have the word random written on them. 112 of these cards only say put the cards that you've revealed on the bottom of your library in a random order. Add to that maybe 80-ish coin flip cards, and then let's say you have cards like Coco and Delver and Aether Flux Marvel. Let's say 100, let's say 200 to be generous. This means, if we say that, it's about 420-440 cards, math is hard. That means that Adventures of the Forgotten Realms add an additional 5% on the existing number of randomized cards to the game of Magic. Now 5% might sound tiny, but in a game like Magic that's been going for 30 years, 5% is a huge uptick in randomization on cards. So we have to concede the fact that Adventures of the Forgotten Realms adds way more variance to the game in terms of cards that resolve with a variant outcome than ever before. So that means people are right to be annoyed, right? No, it doesn't. When we look at the effects of the most powerful or most potentially competitively viable options from the D20 mechanic in Adventures, we quickly realize that they kind of suck. Delina the Wild Mage has a Splinter Twin S combo associated, whether that is not even remotely as good as Twin. It's quite a bit of setup and has a failure rate that has, well, no respecting, self-respecting competitive Magic players going to feel comfortable playing with it. On the flip side, the Mythic deck of many things, and Mythic cards often exemplify the most powerful examples of the mechanics, right? This card does allow you to end the game for an opponent by stealing a creature and then sacrificing it with another piece of the combo, but the card will likely remain unplayable because its downside is just so huge and so likely by comparison. The point I'm getting at is that the cards that have the Roll 20 mechanic on them do add more variance to the game, but they are so underpowered, they are so safe. Wizards of the Coast have played it so safe with every mechanic in this set, which suggests to me that they are peeling away from the obnoxious 24 months or so that we had where everything was overpowered and every format was warped. They're playing it very, very safe. And honestly, that's a testament to them in terms of the design. They've brought a new and interesting thing into it, which can make for some exciting highs and some fun casual gameplay, but it's not gonna warp anything. It's not gonna ruin the game, even if Trevor on your local Facebook group says so. The idea that a treasure chest triggering on a roll of a 20 and ending one game of Limited is enough to get people to take us to social media to be angry about how feel bad it is honestly laughable. I want to relate. I want to show empathy for other people's frustrations, but sometimes it's just unwarranted, unreasonable salt. So, in short, stop crying about D20s, please. I've been Vince, also known as Pleasant Kenobi on the internet. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Let me know what you think in the comment section below. Am I being too flippant and dismissive of these concerns, or are people generally just being way too salty and they need to chill out? Let me know down below. Don't forget to like, comment with letting me know. Smash the bell, subscribe, and check me out on youtube.com/Pleasant Kenobi as well. And I'll see you in the next one. Ta-ta for now.